All right. Good evening, everybody. I was almost late this morning. I had to hook up the dog sled to get up here. I tell you, I got my gloves on. I got my coat on. It's like it's winter again. You know, with the COVID-19 virus thing going around and all the rain we've been getting and the cold weather, it just makes you feel excited about everything, doesn't it? Well, hopefully that we can change that a little bit with a sermon that I have for you from the Lord. And so I hope that you're tuning in. We have about 24 folks that have tuned in so far tonight, so that's good. So I like that. I'm thinking, too, about putting together a Bible study with Zoom sometime in the near future so we can get 12 or 20 people on that sometime during the week. And instead of coming to church, we can just do it from our homes, and we can participate. That should be fun. We'll see about putting that together. I just love to study the Bible, and I know that you all do, too. Well, let me have a word of prayer with you. Then I have some prayer requests, and then I have some announcements, and we'll go from there this evening. It's been a long day. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you and praise you so much for the joy of being able to come together. We thank you, Father, for the technology that we do have, even though we haven't been able to come together for these so many weeks. I thank you, Father, that we can still, through the blessings of all the technology that we currently have, to be able to still have our Bible study, still have our church together. Even though we haven't been together, our church has been together. And Father, we thank you so much for this, the ability and even the money to be able to put together the things that we have. And so, Lord, we just praise you tonight. We thank you so much for the life that we have, the health that we have. We thank you for the blessings of our church, our families. We thank you for our country. Pray, Father God, you might continue to bless and guide it. Lord, we love you, and we look forward to what you're going to do tonight as we go to your word, and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. I think we have a song above all, so let's go ahead from the Tower of Power and put that on for us. Thrones.
who rose, trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above.
That is a lovely song, isn't it? He thought of me above all. Isn't it neat? People think they're not important, but God, the creator of all things, knows your name. That makes you somebody. And so the world may think you're a nobody, but in God's sight, you're a somebody. And that's a wonderful thought. Let me give you a couple prayer requests tonight, just to remind you of some of the things. I hope that you're getting our prayer sheet that we send out every Thursday morning. I didn't get too many prayer requests today or yesterday. Just update a little bit of that. I know Leslie Pease was having trouble with it. Leslie, I don't know if they got that worked out or not, but they have no idea why you're not receiving these. And so if you haven't been getting the prayer letter and you'd like to have that, go ahead and contact Becky or contact me probably, or Becky, and we'll make sure that we get your email on that and you can get those. But just a couple of names I want to just mention to you. Hannah Snuffer. That's Debbie Green's niece, is still having trouble. She's in hospice. A friend of mine from the Greenbrier Church, his name is Ed Tyre, is in the hospital, not doing very well at all. He's had massive health problems for a while, so be praying for Brother Ed. He's a wonderful guy. He's a poet, and he sold many of his poems in church while I was there. Pray for Jill Carver. So far, good news, Jill. We thank God for that. God is working in your life, and even though Dennis is there with you, we'll pray for you. You need it if Dennis is there with you. So let's pray for Jill. So far, she's done real well through her treatments. Be praying for Dorothy Massey's daughter, Tammy. She fell in the kitchen there at Dorothy's, and she broke her arm last week. And so she's kind of waiting till the swelling to go down, and then they're going to do surgery on it. So be praying for Tammy as she gets ready to go through that. Gloria, be praying for Gloria. She went to have her treatments today, but her blood count was down, and so they're going to put that off for a little while. This is her last one, and I hope that all of you are praying very hard that this cancer just kind of goes away, that her hip begins to heal. It's hard to imagine going through something like that, but God brings things into people's lives for purposes, which we're going to talk about this evening. Hard things sometimes, but God's grace is going to be sufficient to get us through whatever God brings into our life. Just a couple things. Chris DeMoro had asked us to pray for a 2-year-old Aaron who had a cancerous tumor on bladder, I think it was. It's a nephew of her daughter-in-law, so be praying for little Aaron. Of course, be praying for my daughter-in-law, Ellen, as she continues to see what's going to happen with her feet. She's been scheduled at the Cleveland Clinic for open heart surgery in September of this year, so be praying that her feet heal up where she can have that. One other thing, just remind you again that we're going to be having a physical service. It's like normal almost that you can come to the church service. What's that, Michael?
7 days.
7 days. We have called the people working in the back. You know, you have Mike, you got Gary, and you have Amy. That's the tower of power in the back. That makes all of this take place. They handle the computers and all that stuff. And Mike is excited about actually having people and not puppets in church. And so I am too. It would be better to have people to talk to than puppets. But I don't know. Some of the puppets look like church members. They have their head back and their mouth open. And you guys don't do that. I just thought I'd say that. But it's going to be next Wednesday. Next Wednesday at 7 o'clock, we'll be having church service here, so you can come. We won't be singing because I understand that's how you can spread the virus, but we'll be doing songs like we are now. You can hum along with it or whatever, and we'll be able to have our service together. It's still not going to be the same. We can't fellowship like we would like to, but it's one step closer to where we have been for the last.
We still will be live
streaming. I was getting there, Michael. He thinks I forget things. I don't understand these guys. But if you can't make it, of course, we're going to be live streaming them just like we are now. Actually, we've been doing this for quite a while. And so if you can't come to church for whatever reason, we're going to be live streaming just like now, the whole service. You'll be able to see it online like you are now. We'll send out a link that you can get to, and you know exactly where to have it. Now, the following Sunday, which will be the 17th, we're going to have our church service for the first Sunday since this has all started. And we're going to have two services on Sunday morning, one at 9 o'clock and one at 11 o'clock. And so what you have to do is go to our website and sign up either for the 9 o'clock or for the 11 o'clock. We're only going to allow 80 people in each service. And so once the 11 o'clock gets filled, then we're going to get bumped. That person will get bumped to the, anybody else signs up to the 9 o'clock in the morning class. We're going to go ahead and live stream the 11 o'clock hour. So that's where you'll be watching the service from then, from the 11 o'clock hour. So the following Wednesday, I think is the 20th, Russ Kearney will be bringing the message instead of me. And so we're going to have Russ and maybe some of the other people in the church starting to fill up some Wednesday nights for us. I'd like to use these guys that God has given the ability to do that sort of thing. Russ used to be the director of CEF here in Beckley a while back, and so he's got a heart for young people for sure. All right, I think we have another song, don't we, fellas? If you have your Bibles, let's go ahead and open those up tonight. Tower of Power, you got to get your Bibles out too now. That's Psalm 143. I want you to turn your Bibles to Psalm 143. It's a 12-verse psalm. And we're just going to dissect it just a little bit and see what the Lord has for us tonight. Before we get into it, let me just tell you a little story. I read the story a while back of this preacher that had lost his family in a fire. It was devastating to him. He lost his family, and he was really depressed, devastated, as you can possibly imagine something like that happening to you. And he was just walking the streets just endlessly. And he happened to be walking down this one road, and he got to where they were constructing a large church. And he was watching the workers, the construction workers there, and he saw this man working on a triangle piece of stone. And he asked the man, "What are you doing?" And the guy said, "You see up there by the steeple? You see that little triangle place?" He says, I'm making a stone that fit in that triangle right there. I'm carving this stone down here so it will fit up there." The preacher got to thinking about it, the things that had happened to him, and he realized that nothing happens in this world unless God allows it. Job's a good book of that. Satan couldn't do anything unless God allowed him to do that. And so when things come into our life that are difficult, realize that God's behind that. And so the preacher began to think about that, and he realized that, hey, God was at work. Even though it was difficult, even though it was hard for him, God was working to make him right here so he would have a place up there. If he could get him fit here, he could get him fit for up in heaven. You know, we live in a world today that's filled with people just like that preacher, people that are going through difficult things, depression, just devastating things happen to them, tragedies that happen to them. People are despondent. People are defeated. I mean, you can see a lot of people just fit those categories. You know, we're supposed to be happy in the Lord. We're supposed to have victory in Jesus. But it's funny, even Christians walk around despondent and depressed, and they despair over things that are happening in their life. And if you think about it, you know, tragedy and difficult things is part of life. And you can think of a lot of famous people that had a lot of tragedy in their life. Abraham Lincoln is one of them. George Washington is another one of them. I have several people, Martin Luther King, Charles Spurgeon, John Adams, Winston Churchill. And maybe somebody in the Bible that we would know about is David. You know, David did a lot of great things, but David had a lot of tragedy in his life. Even though Acts calls him a man after God's own heart, he had a lot of difficulty come into his life. Even the apostles, you know, they were friends of the Lord. He called them for a purpose to take the gospel and expand it to the world, to make the foundation, the doctrinal foundations of the church. And they went through some difficult times. You know, of the 12, 11 of them died. Only John died of old age. And so it doesn't matter who you are. Because you live in a sin-cursed world, you're going to have trials and tribulation when they come into your life. And so the psalm that we're looking at here is a psalm of David. And it's a psalm that I think that came from his life when he was having difficult times. When he was in despair over things, when he was despondent over life. And so I want to spend some time on these verses tonight because I think they're going to help us as we walk through these difficult valleys that we walk through. The COVID-19 virus scare, we're still walking through that. You go to the store, you don't know if you're going to come home with something that you didn't go in there with. One day to the next, you don't know if you might come down with something. We're fortunate here not to have a lot of cases, but in other places, they have lots of cases. And then we start worrying about the economy. What's the economy going to do? You know, the government has put out trillions of dollars. We're already trillions of dollars into debt. How are we ever going to pay for these things? We just keep printing money. How long can we do that? And it begins to take a toll on you. It begins to wear you down. And you realize that, hey, man, we're in some difficult times. Maybe we are heading for a depression. What if I lose my job? What if I lose my house? And so I'm going to use this psalm tonight because David is letting his heart be seen. And as he lets us see his heart, he gives us some things that we can be encouraged on. And what I want to challenge you with tonight is that when you're down in the valley, don't waste it. Because God has put you there for a purpose. God has brought you there for a purpose. You know, I know that many people don't want to believe it, but God is in charge of everything. He just is. How can this terrible thing happen if God loves me? Well, God loves us. The Bible says, "For all things work together for good to them who love God, his children, to them who are the called according to his purpose." Even difficult things happen to those that he loves. His apostles, for instance. David, for instance. Jesus, for instance. And so he brings us into these valleys. And so what we have to learn tonight is don't waste your experience in the valley. God has brought you there for a purpose. And that purpose is to make you stronger and draw you closer to Him. And that's what we need to do. And so remember, the Bible says the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and He delighteth in His way. It may not seem like God has His hand on you, that He's directing you, but He is, if you're in His will, following His precepts, being obedient to the things that He's asked us to do. And so He controls the valleys, and He determines the depth and the length and the duration of those valleys He brings us to. He sends the valley seasons into our lives to develop us and make us more like the Lord Jesus. I mean, that's what we've been predestined to become like. It isn't that we've been predestined for heaven or hell. That's not what the Bible teaches. When the word predestined is used, predestined means to be conformed to the image of His Son. As we yield to the Spirit of God, the fruit of the Spirit begins to take root in our life, and we begin to have love, joy, peace, long-suffering. And when people begin to see us in the will of God, they begin to see the characteristics of Jesus. And so when we pray, Lord, let people see Jesus in me, that's exactly what we're talking about. God working in our lives to make us more like Jesus every day. And so if God loves us, and He does, and if God sends the valleys our way, and He does, we would be foolish to waste the opportunity because He's brought it into our life for a purpose. And so tonight I want to look at three characteristics that I can see here in this psalm. Three characteristics that tells us that we need to value those times in the valley and don't waste them because they're there for a purpose. Number one, and you know this as well as I do, that when you go through a valley, it's a painful thing. So let's look at the pain of the valley first. Look at verse 3. For the enemy has persecuted my soul. Now, this is David speaking. He has crushed my life to the ground. He has made me dwell in darkness like those who have long been dead. We talk about the pain of darkness, the pain of darkness in the valley, because there is no help. David is saying the enemy has crushed his soul. He has made me dwell in darkness. You know? There seems to be no end to his pain, no light at the end of the tunnel. And I think many people can be in that type of valley today. But remember, when you're in that valley, you're never by yourself. Never by yourself. Jesus has promised us, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. He's promised that. When the three Hebrew young men were tossed into the fiery furnace, God was there with them. They said, didn't I cast three people in? And there's four walking around there now, and the fourth one looks like the Son of God. And look at Daniel in the lion's den. Shut the mouth of the lions. No matter where we go, just remember, you're never alone. That's why you have to make Christianity a real thing. Christianity is having a personal relationship with Jesus. John 17:3. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the one true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. And so to be a Christian is to have that intimacy with God, because the more intimate you are with God, the more real He is to you. And just because you can't see something with your eyes doesn't mean it's not real. I can't see this air that I'm surrounded with, but I'm in an ocean of air, an ocean of gases. Without those, I would die. I can't see them, but I need them. And so remember, because you can't see Jesus, because you can't see God, He is still with us. There's a physical world and there is a spiritual world. They're both just as real as the other. And so David begins by talking about the pain of darkness while he's in the valley. But look at verse 4. He talks about the pain of depression. Therefore, my spirit is overwhelmed within me. My heart within me is distressed. In verse 3, he says there's no help. In verse 4, he says he has no heart. It has left him. He's reached the end of his rope, and he doesn't know if he can have that veil of darkness lifted up or not. He just doesn't know. It's interesting. The word overwhelmed here in our text carries the idea of shrouded, being encased in darkness. That's how David is feeling. He's encased in darkness. All he can see is darkness. He has no hope, and he has no heart of ever being released from it. And it says that he was distressed. My heart within me is distressed. That word literally means to be to be stunned, stupefied, the idea of being amazed. And David is amazed that this has happened to him. That's how we are sometimes. Look at me. How can this happen to me? How could I lose my job, lose my house, lose all these different things? How could I come down with this terrible disease? And we feel that way sometimes. That's the pain of the valley, because it brings darkness. It brings depression. And look at verse 7. Answer me speedily, O Lord. My spirit fails. Do not hide your face from me, lest I be like those who go down into the pit. Wow. Don't hide your face from me. Answer me. My spirit fails. It's the pain of despair. The pain of despair. There's no hope. There's no hope. David feels that he's reached the end of his rope. He has no hope. Sometimes when you're in the valley, that's exactly how you feel. You feel like there is no hope. Your heart fails you. And then you're totally, totally despairing over where you are at. The person I think of in that type of environment was Job. He lost all of his wealth. He lost his family. And his wife says, curse God and die. What did he do? Though he may slay me, yet will I serve him. Wow. He had faith. Why? Because God was real to Job. To go through what Job went through in his life, God had to be real to him. And that's why the Bible, in the first two chapters there in Job, God is talking to Satan, and he says, hey, have you considered my servant Job? Because there's nobody perfect and blameless like him in all the earth. Why? Because he had a relationship with God. And that type of relationship will stay you through that valley that you're going through. Yeah, you're going to get despondent. You're going to feel hopeless. You're going to be overwhelmed with despair. But you remember that Jesus is with you. That this is happening for a purpose. The same God who allows good things to come into your life also allows bad things to come into your life. And they both come into your life for a purpose. And that is to make you more Christ-like, to trust him more. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 33 tells us, for all his days, talking about mankind, are sorrowful. Sorrowful. Jesus said in John 16:33, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And so you are going to have trials and tribulations. Did not Jesus have trials and tribulations? I mean, Jesus was crucified. The Son of God, God himself, the creator of all things, was crucified. He allowed his creation to do that to him. And he bore the sins of the whole world, and God poured out upon Jesus on those few hours upon the cross all the wrath that was due, all of mankind for all eternity. Jesus suffered the hell of everyone, and he paid the debt off in full. And that's why he said, it is finished. It is finished. He accomplished what he came to do. He paid a debt that we couldn't pay. And so we think of life as just being in this physical world, but this world only lasts 70, 80, 90 years, and then this world's gone. But there's another world, a spiritual world where God dwells, and we have a home there for us. Jesus said, I go and prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. That's our hope. Even when you're in that valley of despair and despondency and the pain is so gripping you, you have a hope that can never be taken away, because Jesus' tomb was empty. He rose from the dead, and he's coming again for you and for me. I think that's great. Job says in Job 14, verse 1, man that is born of woman, that would be everybody, is a few days and full of trouble. And that's true. Let's face it, the valleys in life are going to come. They just are. But when they come, you and I have to remember that they come from the hand of a loving Father who loves us. And he's in the business of perfecting us to make us into the image of Christ. And so when somebody's going through cancer and they don't have a lot of hope and they're going through treatments and the treatments are terrible and they hurt, they're painful, there's a purpose in that. There's a purpose in that. We're going to talk about it next. You have the pain in the valley, but there's also the prize that comes from the valley. Look at verse 2. Do not enter into judgment with your servant, for in your sight no one living is righteous. No one living is righteous. When you get into a valley, when you get into a difficult thing, one of the things that happens is this. You start to pray. A lot of times when bad things happen, you try to take care of this, you try to take care of this, you try to fix this, you try to fix that. And the key word is there, you. You try to do this and that and the other. But when you get into a situation that's too much for you to do, you finally get to the point where you pray. And the Bible tells us that we should pray always, pray without ceasing, because we have that intimacy with God. Like a husband and wife, they have a relationship, a love relationship with each other. They share back and forth. That's the type of relationship that you and I are to have with our Heavenly Father. We're to love Him like that. And so the prize in the valley, there's three of them. The first one is the prize of repentance. You know, sometimes sin is responsible for the chastisement that God sends our way, for the valley that we find ourselves in, but not all the time. Just because a person has a disease or cancer, whatever it happens to be, doesn't mean that his sin has caused that. We live in a sin-cursed world. But the valleys that God brings into our life, no matter how difficult they are, they have a way of bringing us to our knees where we acknowledge our need of God. We need Him. And the valleys have a way of causing us to reflect on our relationship with the Lord. Anything that brings us closer, closer in that relationship to God is a prize. And so one of the things we get from the valley, one of the prizes that we get from the valley is the prize of repentance. It causes us to see ourselves through the eyes of God. And if there's sin in our life, we repent. And repentance is a change of mind that leads to a change of behavior. To be saved, you have to repent and believe. You turn away from your sinful life because that's going to condemn you to hell. And then you look to God in faith to save you. When you're in a trial, when you're in that valley, in that difficult time, it drives you to your knees. And it makes you look at yourself through the eyes of God. And if there's sin in your life, because you're going through a difficult thing, I guarantee you, you're going to be confessing your sin. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing. Because it makes you right with your Master, with your Lord, with your God. And so you have the prize of repentance, but you also have the prize of remembrance. Look at verse 5. I remember the days of old. I meditate on all your works. I muse or I ponder on the work of your hands. We remember who God is. I mean, I'm sure David knew the stories of his past, what his mother would tell him, or maybe his father Jesse would tell him, you know, how Israel was delivered from bondage. How God led Moses to lead the people out of Egypt. And the plagues that were there, and how God took care of the people in the wilderness for 40 years. Their shoes didn't wear out. I mean, think of the things that God did for those people. So David knew about the past. He remembered the story, but think about the things that David knew about his own life. How God protected him from the bear, and from the lion, and from the giant Goliath, and from Saul himself. David knew that God was there in his life. Sometimes we need to sit there and ponder. We need to reflect upon God's goodness. God's goodness. You think about it. I'm going to die someday if the Lord tarries, and so are you. But my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And so I know this life is going to end, but I have my hope that can never be taken away from me, because I have entrusted myself to the one who never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. I've entrusted myself, and I believe that He's able to keep that which I've committed unto Him. My all, my body, my soul, and my spirit, I have given to God. So when you're walking through that valley, and you feel hopeless, and you feel in despair, and you feel despondent, and you feel hopeless, and your heart is about ready to give out because you can't go through it anymore, remember what God has done for you. Jesus Christ, God's Son, came into this world to die upon that cross in your place, to take upon Himself your sin that was going to send you to hell forever, and He paid it off in full. And when you gave your life to Him, when you trusted Christ with your heart, soul, mind, and spirit, He gives you eternal life. He forgives you your sins, and he has a place in heaven for you. You need to remember that sometimes. God did that for you. So don't get hung up on the 70 or 80 years that you're here, or the pain that you're suffering now. Sure, it hurts, but it won't hurt forever. Because you have a God who loves you so much, he's taking care of the forever part. And he can take care of the for now part as well. And so we have the prize of repentance that brings us closer to God. We have the prize of remembrance, because unless we get into a valley, sometimes we never even think about God. You know, unless something difficult happens to us, many times we don't even open our Bible, we're not praying. But when a difficult things happen to us, it causes us to remember. Repent and remember. And so when we're in the valley, sometimes we need a fresh encounter with God. And that's what he gives to us. There's one more talking about these different prizes that I can see here in these verses. And that is the pride of reliance. Look at verse 6. I spread out my hands to you. My soul longs for you like a thirsty land. Wow. David knew he couldn't produce what he needed, but he knew that God could. He knew that God could. And so he looked to God. You know, your valley has been designed especially for you. Everybody goes through difficult times, but you, when you go through your valley, it's been designed specifically for you. And many times, as you go through that valley, you come to the end of yourself because you realize that you can't do it on your own. Because you can't. And that's because you have to rely upon him. There's reliance upon God. Remember that old poem, Footprints in the Sand? You know, you saw two sets of footprints, and then he just saw one and wondered where God went. And God said, that's when I was carrying you. There's reliance upon God, because without God, what do you have? You have no hope of tomorrow. You have nothing. And when you know God with that intimacy, and you've learned who he is from the book, and you have a one-on-one relationship with him, you commune with him, he communes with you through the word of God, your whole life begins to change. Death isn't something you fear. Death is something that you crave, in the sense of knowing that when it comes into your life, it's simply a doorway into his presence. And so whatever that valley is, and perhaps there's no more difficult of a valley that leads to death than that valley, you realize that it's just a door that goes into your Father's presence. The prize of reliance. God has allowed you in that valley to cause you to become dependent upon him again. Because one of the things that we kind of foster in our lives is a streak of independence. You know, we want to do it ourselves. I'm reminded of Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not unto your own understandings. In all of your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. So you should take your Bibles out, go to Proverbs chapter 3, 5 and 6, and circle that, because that is a great verse. Trust in the Lord with not part of your heart, all your heart, and lean not unto your own understanding. I don't know God while I'm here. Why am I in this terrible valley? I don't know. In all of your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. Let him direct you. Let him steer you. As terrible as the valleys of life can be, remember, they are extremely valuable to us as a people. So I've talked to you tonight about the pain of the valley, the prize of the valley. Let's talk just a moment about the path from the valley. I mean, I'm in this valley. I like to get out of it. So how do I go about doing that? Well, several times in these verses, we're going to look at these verses just in a second, David refers to his prayers. He refers to his prayers. And I'm certain that there were times in David's life when he wanted to stop praying, but he didn't. Why? Because David was a man after God's own heart. Was he perfect? No. I mean, he sinned greatly against God, more than once. But God said, he's special. When Samuel was anointing him, God told Samuel, don't look on the outside, because God looks on the heart. There was something about David's heart that impressed God. And I think one of the things is that he was a person that desired to have that intimacy with God. You know, Psalm 19, you know, you look up to the heavens and you see, man, there has to be a God. There it is. The heavens declare the glory of God. And so one of the paths from the valley is the path of prayer. Look at verse 1. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Give ear to my supplications. In your faithfulness, answer me, and in your righteousness. Wow. And so, hear my prayer, O Lord. David's in a terrible place, and he says, O Lord, hear my prayer. Look at verse 8. Cause me to hear your loving kindness in the morning. Again, he's conversing with God. Look at verse 9. Deliver me, O Lord, from my enemies. He's praying. Deliver me, O Lord, from my enemies. Look at verses 11 and 12. Revive me, O Lord, for your name's sake, for your righteousness' sake. Bring my soul out of trouble. In your mercy, cut off my enemies and destroy all those who afflict my soul. For I am your servant. He's praying. He's praying. We're commanded in the scriptures, as I said earlier, to pray. Pray without ceasing. Pray always. Isaiah 65:24 says, it shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. Speaking of God. And while they are still speaking, I will hear. Our duty as Christian is to pray. Pray when God says yes. Pray when God says no. Because many times God has something better for us. Don't lose heart. But praying is a discipline that most Christians don't really do much of. You know, maybe we sit down at the table and pray at dinner time. Most Christians probably don't. I'm not saying you have to, but I'm thinking the Bible says, in everything give thanks. In everything give thanks. The good, the bad, and the ugly, give thanks. Because that's what God tells us to do. I think of George Washington. My wife loves George Washington. If you ever come to my house, you're always welcome to come when I'm home. Otherwise, they arrest you for coming to my house. But we have pictures in our house of George Washington. My wife is a George Washington fan. And, you know, George went through some difficult things during the American Revolution. Valley Forge was a terrible time. He wasn't even sure his army was going to hold together. People were freezing to death, losing their feet. They had no shoes. And many times they would see George Washington kneeling down in the snow praying. And perhaps you've seen that famous picture of George Washington kneeling down in the snow praying by his horse. George Washington was a godly man. And so we have the path of prayer. But also, look at verse 10, because there's another path. It says, your spirit is good. Lead me in the land of uprightness. It's the path of praise. It's the path of praise. In the midst of the psalm, David sends up praise. He's reminded that God is good. Your spirit is good. Of course God is good. No matter what God brings in your life, God is good. God is good. And so we worship him. We don't accuse him. We don't accuse him. We know that he has a purpose for whatever he brings into our life. I may not understand it in this life, but the Bible says to him, give thanks for all things. Cancer, give thanks for all things. God has a purpose in what he's bringing into your life. He has a purpose for that valley that he's brought you into. And while you're in that valley, you need to praise him. You need to praise him. I think of some of our hymn writers that we have. Luther Bridges, who wrote, There's Within My Heart a Melody. He penned that song after losing his entire family in a house fire. Horatio Spafford wrote a song that I love to sing. I don't sing very well. It Is Well With My Soul. After he lost his four children at sea in a shipwreck. That's a tough one, isn't it? Praising God in that valley. Giving praise to God. But if you can't praise God when you're in the valley, I might say you have no business praising him when you're on the mountaintop. Because the same God on the mountaintop is the same God in the valley. So we need to learn to praise him. And I wonder if you can only praise him up here and you don't praise him much down here, I wonder how genuine your praise is, how genuine your worship is. Because don't you find it, as I find it, it's easy to praise God up here. Everything's going great. But when the bottom falls out of the boat, oh, woe is me. You don't think of God too much. You don't praise him for what he's doing. Genuine worship, genuine praise comes from the heart. And it doesn't matter if you're up here or down here. It comes from here. Because God never changes. He's always there with you. I'll be with you always, Tim Dillon, even to the end of the world. And there's one more I want you to see. And that's the path of practice. Look at verse 8, the second part of verse 8. It says, for this cause I do trust. Cause me to know the way in which I should walk, for I lift up my soul to you. God, guide me in the way I should walk. The path of practice. letting him guide us and direct us. That's what we have to learn to do. And so remember, there's pain. There's pain in these things that comes our way. There's pain in the valley. But there's also a prize to be won for walking through the valley. And you have to remember that there's a path God will allow you to get out of it. You know, I think of 1 Corinthians 10, that he tells that there is a way that you will escape. And maybe that way of escaping is death. I don't know. But my life doesn't end here physically. My life goes on. I have eternal life. A few years ago, I'm going to close with this. This is something I wanted you to know. A few years ago, John Piper, I don't know if you know him, he writes a lot of books, had prostate cancer. And he wrote a book about that, and it calls Don't Waste Your Cancer was the name of it. Don't Waste Your Cancer. Kind of a strange thing. But he mentions 10 mistakes that people make when they deal with cancer that causes them to miss what God is doing in their lives. And I just want to read these to you without elaborating too much. This is what John Piper wrote, a fine man of God. Number one, you will waste your valley if you do not believe it was designed for you by God. God had a purpose for it. Number two, you will waste your valley if you think it is a curse and not a gift. In all things, give thanks. Number three, you will waste your valley if you spend too much time reading about your valley and not enough time reading about Christ. Don't we do that? Number four, you will waste your valley if you allow it to drive you into solitude instead of allowing it to deepen your relationship with others. Don't crawl into a hole. Use that as a stepping stone to lead others to Christ. Number five, you will waste your valley if you grieve as those that have no hope. I know you're going through some pain and going through some suffering. I can't imagine. Maybe someday I will be able to. But I know that God has a purpose for it. And I know that I have a hope that can never be taken away. I know that someday Jesus is coming. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. And then those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Amen. We got a hope that no one can take away from us. Number six, you will waste your valley if you treat sin as casually as you did before the valley. Number seven, you will waste your valley if you fail to use it as a means of witnessing to the glory and the truth of Jesus Christ. And so let's just go with those seven. Are you wasting your valley? Or are you making an account for Jesus? Nobody likes to go through valleys. But God, your Heavenly Father, has a purpose for bringing them into your life. We may not know what it is, this side of heaven. But rest assured, it's for a purpose. And the same God who loves you. And you know he loves you because he sent your son to die in your place so you could come and live with him forever. Has allowed this to come into your life for a purpose. So glorify him. Give him honor. Give him glory. And don't waste your valley. Use it for God's glory. Father, I thank you so much tonight for just the blessings of Jesus. And Lord, I know that I've gone through trials, but not like some people I know are going through them. I can't imagine what it's like. But Lord, I know that your grace is always sufficient and you have a purpose in everything that takes place. And I know that not all things are good, but all things work together for good. And so, Lord, we just trust you. And we look forward, Father, to someday having the mind of Christ and knowing the answers that we seek. So, Lord, we love you and we thank you so much for tonight. And Lord, as we pray for these on our prayer list, I pray, Father God, that you might be glorified. Help us not just to pray to see people physically well again, though that's why we do pray, but Lord, help us to pray for their spirituality. We have many people on our prayer list that aren't saved. And so, Father God, help us to pray for them, that your Spirit would speak to their heart, that they might see Christ with their eyes, their physical eyes now, and then their spiritual eyes, and come to that saving knowledge of who Jesus is. And so, Father, we thank you for tonight. We pray as we look forward to next Wednesday night coming together. Lord, we just pray that things continue to go well here in West Virginia. We pray, Father God, here in Raleigh County that we don't see any increases of the virus. And Father, we pray for some warmer weather. We need some sunshine to bring up people's spirits. And so, God, we love you. We thank you so much for sending Jesus to die on the cross for us. God, we thank you that we have a friend that we can't even possibly imagine who never leaves us. Father, help us to glorify him today. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, and we'll see you Sunday here on the internet. And then the following Sunday will be in person. So make sure you sign up for those two services that we're going to be having on Sunday. Don't forget, next Wednesday is going to be right here. God bless you, and we'll see you then.